Grace and peace to you from the one who was and is to come. Amen. The curtain is still closed. The audience has fallen silent. The orchestra begins with the overture and prepares the visitors for what is to come in the opera. Musical motifs anticipate the mood of the play, the central themes of the plot, and a brief outline of the characters. Based on the first impressions of the musical preface, the audience will be transported into another world. In our Bible, we get to hear such an overture no less than 73 times in succession. 46 times in the Old Testament and 27 times in the New Testament. Every biblical book begins with such a preface, inviting us to witness the beginning of a new story and enter its narrative world. And as the plot thickens, the main motives laid out in the beginning gain momentum and clarity. This also applies to the Acts of the Apostles. Here are the opening verses of its preface. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them his command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift of my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." This is the first part of Luke's overture to the Acts of the Apostles. I wonder if you belong to those who enjoy reading the preface of a new book, or do you usually go straight into the story? To make time for the foreword is to give the author a chance to speak directly and personally to us. We read about Luke's motivation, his sources, and his own unique perspective. His foreword breathes the spirit of his own time. We are briefed about the personal and historical circumstances that gave rise to the book and are given clues on what to look out for in the unfolding plot. Luke begins his preface with addressing a certain Theophilus. Very succinctly, he provides him with the essential information needed to understand his motivation for writing a second book. He refers Theophilus back to the first book known to us as the Gospel of Luke, which seems to be foundational for what he is about to write. Already in the preface to his gospel, Luke chose Theophilus as his preferred partner of dialogue in order to offer his own unique perspective on the life and ministry of Jesus of Nazareth. Luke's second book, the Acts of the Apostles, is said to build on his gospel writing, assisting the readers to understand how the first disciples became courageous witnesses to the life and ministry of Jesus. By beginning both the Gospel and the Acts of the Apostles with a direct address to Theophilus, Luke manages to establish a narrative arc between both books. In his preface to the Acts of the Apostles, Luke emphasizes how the apostles, the main actors of the second book, were not only chosen by Jesus himself, but also guided by the Spirit to become faithful witnesses of the gospel. From a narrative perspective, the apostles guarantee the continuity between Jesus' ministry and what unfolded after his ascension. Jesus is said to have presented himself to them as risen and alive. Over a period of 40 days, he has shown himself to them and taught them about the kingdom of God. With just a few key words, Luke is able to show the strong connection and continuity between the historical Jesus and the risen Christ. Luke then tells us about a private conversation between the risen Christ and his apostles around a shared meal. They are instructed not to leave Jerusalem until they receive the gift of God's Spirit, which will empower them to continue his ministry. While John only baptized with water, The apostles will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Just as Jesus' public ministry began with a baptism, the apostles' public ministry will also begin with a baptism. This time it will be a baptism of Spirit and fire. But there is a burning question on the apostles' mind, which they are finally able to share with the risen Christ. They want to know when they can expect the fulfillment of the promised kingdom of God. Christ's answer is sobering and disappointing. Times and dates will not be given to them. The final fulfillment is dependent on God's initiative. Their hope is not to be tied to an immediate outcome, but rather to a firm commitment to remain courageous, wise, kind, and loving. This is why they need to be empowered by the Spirit to become bold witnesses of Jesus' vision for the world and to carry it to the ends of the earth. It is a vision that is meant to transcend the boundaries of Israel and reach all the nations. After Christ's ascension on Mount of Olives, the group returns to the upper room in Jerusalem. Now the names of the 11 apostles are confirmed. Judas is no longer among them. The apostle Peter is listed first and given the special position of being the spokesperson. But the inner circle of disciples is expanded 3 times. We first hear about a group of women who will play an important role in the formation of the first congregation. Mary, the mother of Jesus, is mentioned by name, and she is joined by Jesus' brothers. We then read about Peter addressing a group made up of 120 believers, whom he addresses as brothers and sisters. And finally, Peter raises the need to find a replacement for Judas. The candidate would have been with them from the time of John's baptism to Jesus' ascension. 2 candidates are nominated. After time of prayer, they cast lots and appoint Matthias as the 12th apostle. Together with the apostles, all those mentioned make up the group of witnesses who identify themselves as Jesus' family or the new family of God. This is Luke's way of paying tribute and saying thank you to the first witnesses who were prepared to follow Jesus' instructions to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. Without them, Rondebosch United wouldn't be non-existent. But for now, these witnesses are not to appear in public. They are told to wait together for the pouring out of God's Spirit. Luke's overture has set the stage for the constitution of the first congregation. Various motifs anticipate the story's hopeful mood. The main characters of this event are introduced and honored as courageous witnesses. They are to guarantee that the Jesus story continues. Their witness will be inspired by an outpouring of God's Spirit. The plot promises to start with a loud bang and to take us to the ends of the earth. And the invitation to the audience is to not simply remain curious listeners, but active participants. Indeed, the stage is set. Kim Thitikay's textile art offers a fitting backdrop for the Spirit as the main character and actor in the plot. We witness an energy which is both disruptive and consoling. The abstract shapes and patterns of this art form speak to the combination of careful planning and spontaneous creativity. Individual strands are woven together into something unsettling and exciting. And as the curtain opens, we are drawn into the ever-unfolding story of God's unreserved and undivided love for the world.
Moving in my heart, I
And then the Spirit came upon them. According to Luke, they heard a sound like the blowing of a violent wind coming from heaven, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And with the Spirit came the fulfillment of an ancient threefold dream. The dream of a deeper understanding, a deeper participation, and a deeper sharing. The experience was both energizing and unsettling. And what unfolded was a combination of exuberant generosity and bold subversion. We witness a way of being community which clearly resembles the kind of fellowship Jesus practiced with his inner circle of disciples. A deeper sense of understanding and participation led to a more generous sharing, a sharing of prayers, dreams, visions, bread, and money. No one was left hungry or in need. It is a unity in the Spirit which is centered around a genuine embodiment of the Word. Bold statements of faith led to a community built of living stones, a place of belonging and of genuine care. It is the kind of space where you are not afraid to ask for help. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. God's Spirit points to something that is larger than ourself, something we share with God and God shares with us. Richard Rohr therefore rightly describes the Holy Spirit as the loving immensity of God's presence within us. To receive the Spirit is then to be filled with such divine loving presence. Those who encountered Jesus experienced the presence of such a divine love in the way he interacted with them and cared for them. To experience such presence within us is to be able to breathe deeply and know ourselves held in love. It expands the heart and awakens a deep compassion for those struggling to breathe. Next time you are overcome by fear or overwhelmed by gospel anxiety or eco-anxiety, think of every deep breath you take to calm yourself as an invitation to reconnect with the loving immensity of God's presence within you. Jesus thinks of such presence as an ever-giving spring welling up within us. In our Pentecost story, the Spirit evokes this deep desire inside of people to seek genuine connection and community. The Spirit does not point them back to the Ten Commandments. She does not rely on a new ethical code of conduct. She simply points the individual members to each other and sensitizes them for each other's needs. And she evokes a giving which is not driven by charity, but by a strong sense of divine abundance waiting to be shared. For people are to receive not what they deserve, but what they need. We are told that all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. What an extraordinary vision is unfolding before our eyes. Some would say, too beautiful, and too generous to be true? Is this real or just an utopian dream? New Testament scholars will tell us that Luke is writing about 50 years after Pentecost in order to address some of the challenges within his own congregation. He's taking his congregants back to the beginning in order to inspire them. His intention is not to be historically accurate, but to paint an astounding beginning that makes one dream of a beautiful ending. For when the Spirit moves, nothing is impossible. From the Apostles' letters, we know that the early Christian congregations were not as unified and caring as Luke's Pentecost account seems to suggest. Paul had to deal with divisions and conflicts, rivalry and careless indifference. Bread and personal wealth were not shared freely. Even Luke himself tells us 3 chapters later how Ananias and Sapphira only pretended to be giving and caring. In the end, it is not their greed, but their dishonesty that leads to their fall from grace. To think of Luke's Pentecost account as an utopian ideal is rather disappointing and sobering. But it also is a relief for those of us who realize how far off we are from the kind of solidarity the Spirit is said to be able to inspire. Luke's retelling was then a kind of remembering in order to reassemble and reunite his congregation around the loving immensity of God's presence within them. It was a daring and prophetic proclamation to inspire our imagination. Or to speak with the theologian Fulbert Stefanski, the story is not told because it was so, but because it should be so. Memory says once upon a time, because that is how it should and will be. The successful beginning promises a happy ending. Luke's gloriously idealized account of the first congregation is therefore meant to provoke us and awaken the longing to become who we are called to be as a faith community. And are there not moments in all congregations where something of that vision does materialize, even if only for a moment? There's a sudden spaciousness that makes room for the Spirit of love to move. Stefanski also reminds us that human beings do not only become beautiful by their actions, but also by their dreams. There are dreams that speak of a greater thirst and a broader vision which leaves no one wanting. But it is easy to become despairing and lose hope when we compare our daily reality with Luke's utopian ideal of what it means to be a faith community. The actual outcome of our attempts to be more faithful to Christ's vision often lacks such spirited and abundant generosity. This applies especially to the way the newly constituted congregation shared all their wealth and resources to lift fellow members out of poverty. Cynthia Bogo, a modern-day mystic and Episcopal priest, addresses the dilemma of this vast gap between our utopian aspirations and our everyday reality. She warns us about tying our hope to concrete outcomes. This applies also to the challenges we face in such a highly unequal society as ours, or to the lack of political commitment to save our planet from an environmental catastrophe. Bourgault therefore argues that our great mistake is that we tie hope to outcome. In a similar vein, Brian McLaren, public theologian and activist, insists that our prime motive should be love and not hope. Hope is alive when we are able to see a likely path to our desired outcome. But the moment we cannot see a possible path, we tend to fall into despair and struggle to keep hope alive. Hope always remains vulnerable to defeat and should therefore not be tied to outcome, but rather to our commitment to stay in the place of love. For the moment we make love our primary driving force, a different logic begins to frame our actions. Our courage and confidence is no longer dependent on the likelihood of a successful outcome, but rather grounded in our commitment to stay in the place of love. For love does not rely on a good outcome. McLaren helps us to see the power and beauty of such love when he argues, love may or may not provide a way through to a solution to our predicaments, but it will provide a way forward in our predicament, one step into the unknown at a time. He describes such commitment to love as fierce love. Such fierce love is able to sustain us in order to persevere long enough until a new way may appear, unexpectedly, giving us reasons to be hopeful again. But even if such love does not materialize, it is love that is able to carry us through to our final breath. In other words, when we lose hope for a good outcome, we do not have to give up on remaining committed to staying in the place of love, which is to remain courageous, wise, kind, and loving, despite feeling the resistance of all that is pulling us down and weighing on our heart. McLaren sees the possibility of a sustained declaration of love arising within us. We will live as beautifully, bravely, and kindly as we can, as long as we can, no matter how ugly, scary, and mean the world becomes, even if failure and death seem inevitable. Experiences of failure and even death carry the potential to bring us closer to such a declaration of the heart. For love is able to give birth to a hope which empowers us to suffer wisely and generously without falling into despair. And Richard Rohr is convinced that hope tied to love creates a greater spaciousness. You come out much larger, and that largeness becomes your hope. Stephen Charleston, a retired American Episcopal bishop and academic, believes that it is ultimately not science, but love, which has the power to stop the environmental apocalypse. As a citizen of the Choctaw Nation in Alaska and a Native American elder, he is committed to help faith communities rediscover the earth as their mother who sustains them as a loving parent. Such faith can succeed where science has failed. And it is grounded in the kind of love which gathers people around two basic questions. Where were you in nature when you experienced a vision of such beauty that it took your breath away? And how did that make you feel? Building resilience involves also knowing when to step back and gain a fresh perspective on what will keep hope alive even when failure seems inevitable and we despair about our own powerlessness. To lose hope for a good outcome does not mean we have to give up remaining committed to staying in the place of love, which is to remain courageous, wise, kind, and loving. It is the crucified Jesus who remains our inspiration on this journey. He stayed in the place of love to the end, and in that way kept hope alive. And does the Spirit not try to inspire the same kind of faithfulness and devotion, the firm commitment to remain courageous, wise, kind, and loving? So as you leave from here, come, Spirit of God, and bless us with the courage to dream again and to do the small things with great love. Amen.